Welcome. My name is Laura Rogers Bennett, and this is the Coastal Marine Science Institute and Bodega Marine Lab seminar series. It's my pleasure to host today's seminar, and we are going to be hearing from Dan Okamoto. Dan is a combination of field researcher, statistician, modeler, and he takes all of those observations he's able to make in the field and applies them to his work with population and community dynamics. So it's my pleasure to host him. He has a lot of experience here in California, having gotten his PhD at UC Santa Barbara, and has done several postdoctoral research positions at Simon Fraser University up in BC, the Hawkeye Institute at Florida State University, where he is now an assistant professor. So at the end of the seminar, we're going to post our questions in the Q&A, and I'll be reading them off. And I look forward to this presentation. Thank you very much, Dan. He'll be talking about attending to spatial complexity and equity in ecological research and analysis. Thank you.
Thanks, Laura, and thanks to all of you for letting me speak to you today. It's a pleasure in part because my group and we're going to be doing some work out of Bodega Bay over the next few years. And so it's really nice to be able to present some of this work to you all. And before I jump in, let's see if I can do an advance here. Okay. And so before I jump in, I'd like to acknowledge my funding sources that have made a lot of this work possible. So we've gotten money from Florida State University, National Science Foundation, the Hawkeye Institute has been very supportive, as well as Parks Canada, Council Haida Nation, Heiltsik Nation, and NSERC up in Canada, the equivalent of the NSF up in Canada as well. And I'd like to also acknowledge a bunch of the collaborators that have put a lot of work into some of the work that I'll present. So Lynn Lee up in Guayanas, Dan McNeil, Vanessa Bellis, and Giselle Gisjoktinas up at Haida Fisheries, as well as my PhD student, Nate Spindle, who's done a bunch of work with me lately and an undergrad who's working with us, Tony Capolino. Folks at the Hawkeye Institute, the Lassia Environmental Nature United in Canada, as well as Laura and Rachel, who are now collaborators on our new NSF grant, Aaron Galloway and Julie Schramm at OIMB and now at University of Alaska Southeast, as well as Dan Reed and Steve Schroeder, who've worked with me for a while now on a bunch of that urchin larval settlement work. And I should also, before we kind of jump into the work, I think it's important to recognize that the traditional territories where I work. So I'm actually presenting to you guys from Duwamish territory, or the ancestral territories of the Duwamish people up in the Pacific Northwest, where I'm from, and been spending time waiting for the Canadian border to open so we can go do our field work. I also work down in Florida State, which is the ancestral homelands of the Seminole Tribe of Florida, Miccosukee Tribe of Florida, and the Miccosukee Creek Nation. And of course, I work up in Haida Territory, Heiltsik Territory, and various other indigenous nations along the coast, many of whom are either still there or displaced. So a lot of the work that we do in our lab is really focused on trying to understand population dynamics and community dynamics in coastal ecosystems, and trying to understand how we can quantify those dynamics in ways that can be useful for thinking about conservation and management implications that are important for both people and ecosystems. And one of the challenges in trying to do that is trying to disentangle various different kinds of dynamics. And we're thinking about things like adult dynamics, and those are often less variable but highly influential than things like the demographics that contribute to recruitment, that are hugely volatile, but also can be highly influential and depending on the species and life history of those species. And for a lot of the species that we work in, things like Pacific herring, massive periods of poor recruitment are often blamed for population collapses when they coincide with heavy harvest or over harvest or sometimes mismanagement. or preventing the population recovery following some of that mismanagement. And we can also have massive unregulated anomalous recruitment that can destabilize ecosystems. So this is an kind of odd example in Florida Bay, where we were kind of surprised to find all this literature looking at denuded seagrass beds when urchins have massive amounts of recruitment and overrun the seas, the seagrass beds, much like they do in kelp forest systems that many of us are familiar with. And so again, what we try to do in the lab is try to understand what it is that structures population viability and stability in space and time, and try to utilize that knowledge and information to be valuable in trying to understand trade-offs in management, and also just how populations and communities are structured and how that might change over time. And of course, the value of that is trying to understand how different decisions that we actually, the management of people, how that can feed back into the ecosystem and then influence different kinds of human communities and their well-being. And so originally I was going to talk a lot about fisheries models, but since I've been sitting inside for the last year and a half, deprived of being able to go and access a bunch of my field sites, I decided instead that I was actually going to tell a lot more interesting natural history stories over the course of the talk, and talk a lot about urchin barrens and their dynamics in different places along the coast. And then it'll end with some of the more conservation oriented issues that we're dealing with, particularly in terms of trying to integrate issues of equity into how we think about trade-off analysis in the management of coastal ecosystems. So kelp forests tend to dominate temperate and Arctic subtidal reefs and the sub Antarctic as well. And anywhere you tend to find kelp forests, you also tend to find the capacity for massive explosions in urchin barrens in those habitats. Now, kelp forests are some of the most productive ecosystems on the planet. We've been measuring a lot of these kind of characteristics to look at what kind of productivity is lost when you have urchin barrens explode. And in many cases, you can have urchin and kelp forests coexist, right? Many of us have seen these examples where urchins are just hanging out in their holes or hanging out in the deep and waiting for the excess production of kelp or other macroalgae to come to them. But you, of course, can have scenarios where there's just too many individuals or too much demand, and that overruns the ecosystem to turn into a denuded seascape that looks like this. And so some of our core questions are, why is it that some barrens are stable over time, and while others are quite volatile, like this example in San Nicolas Island in Southern California. And of course, this has massive implications for productivity of near-shore ecosystems, on conservation. So abalone, for example, or especially in the north, are really dependent on kelp for food and shelter. And this is an endangered species up in Canada. And then they're also kind of massively important for fisheries. There's nearshore ecosystems, and urchins in particular are quite a valuable and lucrative fishery. And so the outline of the talk today, first I'm gonna talk a little bit about the demography of purple urchins in California and thinking about things like the effects of living in a barren on the fecundity of animals and how that makes us think about the population dynamics. I'll also describe some of the spatial temporal trends in larval supply and how we're moving towards trying to understand what shapes those and what the implications are, and then trying to disentangle that impact of recruitment versus mortality in shaping urchin barren dynamics in Southern California and Northern California. And then I'll move up north, up into Haida Gwaii and other areas in British Columbia, where we're really trying to examine the physiological feedbacks that happen in red urchin barrens that allow for these things to persist for so long in these crazy little animals. And then I'll talk about some efforts in kelp forest restoration from red urchin barrens and the collaborations that make those potentially successful and the life history characteristics that make those potentially successful as well. And then I'll end with talking a little bit about the injection of the need for equity in science and conservation and management in a system of fields that are interrelated between management, science, and academia that have these feedbacks that can have the capacity for generating inequities. So when we're thinking about urchin barrens, one of the keys to understand is that, you know, many of these things happen at fairly large scales that are both visible and impactful, and they can happen fast. So this is when I first started my PhD back in 2009, I had watched this urchin barren form over the course of about a year and a half, and these are just Google Earth images of our dive transects. And the middle is there is our boat anchored at the same spot. And those GPS points are the transects. And you could see just the erosion of that kelp forest happened pretty rapidly because the numeric response of a massive impulse of animals into the system. And when you crack open animals in that habitat, you find that they're largely just empty, these little zombies walking around that should have tons of yellow gold, the uni that we would like to eat, but instead we're just kind of left with this brown film. And so these animals are wandering around in really just kind of this food depauperate state, but somehow able to persist. And so one of the questions we had was really, does overgrazing result in this net decline in reproductive capacity of the system? So despite the fact that you have massive increases in the number of animals in the system, the food effect on the per capita reproductive capacity, how much does that scale up to the number of zygotes produced per meter squared? Do we have this kind of scenario where we think about kind of this different kind of competition that leads to more of a saturating effect, or something where we see the complete collapse of the reproductive capacity of the system to where we really have reproductive sinks? And so just to give you a little context and an example of how we can look at the dynamics of these systems, this is Carpinteria Reef in Santa Barbara, or near Santa Barbara in Ventura County. And what you see is this increase in urchins over time, because and that tends to be associated with this increase in the number of juveniles. And this is a fairly modest density. This is a decent density of urchins that really overruns the kelp forest and leads to a decline. Whereas right next door at the Mohawk Reef that some of you may know, we have a modest density of urchins, but it's fairly mild with mostly just a kind of a trickle of recruitment into the system that tends to be fairly stable. And that overgrazing at Carpinteria leads to this collapse in algae. Whereas in that area that has, at Mohawk, that has fairly high, but kind of modest densities of urchins, we actually have quite a bit of kelp production that doesn't seem to be impacted by the abundance of urchins, mainly because they're sitting in piles waiting for food to come to them. And what we end up seeing is this decay in size structure at the Carpinteria Reef because of a lot of new individuals being added to the system and a higher, what we believe to be a higher mortality rate on average in that location. Versus Mohawk, which we have a fairly large individuals over time. So this is these are quantiles and kind of the means of the test diameter of those animals. And so this is a fairly small size distribution. It's fairly tight, even though there's a lot of animals in that system versus a fairly widespread and mean average size that's fairly large. And there's a bunch of sites like this. So Southern California, especially in Santa Barbara, we tend to have these mosaics of urchin barrens that occur along the mainland of the coast. And so to answer this question, we were trying to go out and basically spawn animals in the lab. So bring them back to the lab and spawn them basically until they couldn't release eggs anymore, just to kind of get a batch estimate of standing crop of viable eggs, and then enumerated the eggs over time. And I don't suggest that anybody does this. This is actually, it's quite successful. It's also laborious. You have to sit there and inject animals for something like 24 to 48 hours. And the animals that survive, the ones that we were able to get eggs out of, we were able to basically also dissect the gonads to make sure we were getting all the viable eggs at that point in time. And what we can do is we can construct these fecundity size relationships between the animals in the barrens and the animals in the kelp forests. And what we see is massive reductions in size associated with those animals, many of whom are not reproductive. They're just not producing any gametes whatsoever. And the ones that do, it's very few and far between. And both males and females are showing those trends. And when we integrate those size distributions with those size-specific fecundity curves and scale up across the number of individuals in those patches, we can see this massive reduction both per female and per meter squared in these habitats. So because of the massive reduction in per female, the per capita egg production, it doesn't matter how many individuals you have in those patches, there's no way it can overcome the reductions in gamete production per individual. And so what we end up with is a scenario where we've got nearly a 99.9% reduction in patch scale and per capita reproductive capacity in these habitats. And so what we end up with is a scenario where purple urchin barrens in these high density urchin barrens tend to be reproductive sinks when they've really denuded that kelp to a high degree, as we see in many of these Santa Barbara urchin barrens. And this can happen very quickly. So we did experiments looking at feeding the animals at different points in time leading up to the reproductive season. And what we can see is that we collect animals from the barrens and from the kelp forests, we see massive increases in the gonad index and massive declines in the gonad index of animals we had starved. And so over the course of just a few months, basically within a season, we can see the responses of those animals. So this can happen quite quickly and doesn't require the inertia of responses that we might expect of many other taxa. And so what we see is in these systems that urchins are really just not producing a lot of gametes in these habitats as might be expected, but it's much more than we expect just from using the gonad index alone, because even animals that had a modest amount of gonads are not producing a lot of gametes because they're reserving that energy, we believe, for to try to persist through the barren state. And I'll talk a little bit about a bunch of the energetics later on in the talk. So if these animals, if we see these large increases in abundance, and if that is commensurate with basically a large decline locally in reproductive capacity, then we wouldn't expect there to be a large relationship between the adult abundance and the reproductive capacity as we would think about for something like a stock recruit relationship. And indeed, when we analyze recruitment data, we basically see very little evidence for a strong stock recruit relationship that you would expect from some other fisheries. And so when we're trying to think about the factors that can drive recruitment in the system, we have to turn to the other area of life history in this taxa, which is something like the larval stage. Now, of course, this is a little bit challenging when we're thinking about purple urchins or other urchins in general. These species have planktonic larval durations that can be more than a month. And in some cases, you know, upwards of several months, which makes for a challenge in thinking about both the connectivity and the influence of the drivers that can affect the number of new individuals coming into any individual given reef or a region. And so we have questions associated about what is the role of settlement and recruitment in shaping urchin dynamics and the boom and bust cycles that we tend to observe in urchin populations in both Southern and Northern California. And so in order to address that question, we first have to try to understand what does it drive settlement in space and time. And so we've been monitoring since 1990. I've only been involved in the project since 2009. But since 1990, biweekly settlement patterns, and we can use some spatial temporal models to try to disentangle the noise to estimate trends in those dynamics. And then we can try to identify potential drivers of settlement patterns. And we can, of course, throw fancy statistical models at these. But of course, what we end up needing is experiments and process-based modeling to try to understand the plausible hypotheses for what drives variation in settlement and whether or not that's impactful. And then, of course, there's the question of whether settlement matters in the first place and whether that affects recruitment and benthic dynamics. So we can estimate settlement and recruitment relationships in the field, but then we can also evaluate the degree to which those settlement inputs are impacting the changes in adult dynamics by using integrated population dynamics models. So we have these settlement arrays in Southern California. There are six of them in Southern California. And there's only one site, unfortunately, that has persisted in Northern California up at Point Cabrillo and Port Fort Bragg. And what we do is you have these brushes and they're anchored or either off a pier or on the benthos. And we basically go back to these lines and collect the brushes and try to sort out the number of new little settled urchins that are about, you know, less than 500 microns in these brushes every 2 weeks. And this gap associated with the pandemic has been the first time there's been really multi-year gaps in these data sets, which is really unfortunate. Fort Bragg's still going, and we're getting lots of little larvae or new settlers coming in right now. So unfortunately, the brushes are noisy. There's lots of different counts of different species that are not independent because of subsampling. we're really sampling something we can't observe, which is the full settlement out in the ocean. And there are spatial and temporal correlations in those samplers. So we basically filter these data through some sophisticated statistical models to try to estimate the trends. And what we get is output that looks like this. So we've got seasonal trends that we try to tease out, as well as the interannual trends from the data. And so this is one site that caveat appear. We have the average seasonal trend on the top left here, the gray. I don't know if you guys can see my pointer, but we also have the biweekly estimates that are associated with the data, as well as the interannual trend that's teasing out the seasonal signal and trying to estimate kind of what the standardized interannual trend is. And so we can get a time series trend that looks like this by filtering those out. And so we have high seasonal synchrony within regions. But of course, we have something that's a little bit different in Northern California in your region. And these are tend to be these patterns of seasonality. This is the average seasonal trend, tends to line up with the average productivity of chlorophyll. In these cases, these are metrics from satellite-derived chlorophyll. But of course, the interannual trends we find have actually very little to do with those fluctuations in primary productivity. But what we do find is that regionally, we find really strong synchrony within regions. So we only have one site at Fort Bragg, but within the Santa Barbara Channel, the interannual trends tend to be highly synchronous, with the exception of Anacapa Island, which is somewhere between the San Diego and the Santa Barbara sites. The San Diego sites tend to be synchronous. They've actually fallen off. There's not been a lot of settlement in the recent years, and they used to have similar responses to what we see in Santa Barbara. But there's opposite trends. A good year in Fort Bragg tends to be a poor year in Santa Barbara and vice versa. And of course, we can throw all these statistical models at these data to try to find out what's going on. And what we come up with, no matter how simple or sophisticated it is that we tend to see these El Nino temperature correlations with what's going on and with opposite trends in Southern California and Northern California, with no real detectable impacts of things like chlorophyll, kelp upwelling, or the adult densities. And this is mildly unsatisfying. It's interesting because we see different responses in Northern versus Southern California, but El Nino trends can drive a lot of different patterns that can impact a lot of different processes. And so, you know, we have a few ongoing hypotheses for why we might see these trends. There's some evidence. So the temperatures that are experienced by the larvae and the adults during in Southern California, even during the warmest years, are really sublethal temperatures. You have to get really down into Baja to see those temperatures that are really high. So we don't necessarily believe that these are impacts of like instantaneous type heat waves that are really just gonna kill everything. But we do have some evidence that there is some limitations to reproduction. So healthy animals that otherwise have lots of energy for spawning may actually start to resorb or not produce a lot of gametes during those periods that are leading up to the spawning period. And we end up seeing that there's some estimates of thresholds about 17, 18 degrees of being an upper temperature threshold for the long-term gametogenesis during that fall period. So that's one hypothesis. The other is that we think there's some really strong shifts in ocean circulation patterns between the El Nino and La Nina years. So this is Gaviota Pier. And Rachel Simons has done a bunch of reverse particle tracking just to try to understand for a particle that might arrive at Gaviota Pier, where might it have come from in a particular month or a particular year? And this is, if we look at the 90, like an El Nino versus a La Nina year, we end up seeing very different distributions of where those things come from because of retention times within the channel and the distribution of patterns of connectivity among different areas in Southern California. So there are strong stochastic shifts in ocean circulation that happen even in among years. And so this idea of using kind of a mean connectivity matrix for trying to understand oceanographic conditions can be really erroneous, but these fluctuations may be able to explain patterns in the dynamics of larval recruitment. And the other thing that's really important is that you can do experiments to try to look at thermal tolerances, but of course the responses may be different depending on where those animals come from. So we've done some work with fertilization rates. This isn't with pH, but same principle applies. So looking at northern populations, so in Northern California and Oregon versus Santa Barbara, where you have different histories of exposure and where you get low exposure of extreme events, the southern population is much more sensitive to those pH effects on those low pH events on fertilization dynamics than the northern population. So of course there's geographic effects of those sensitivities that need to be taken into account when trying to think about some of these hypotheses. So I'm presenting some of this just because for the folks at BML, the work that we're going to be doing out there is basically trying to combine experiments that are looking at some of these direct thermal effects on reproductive performance and energetics and larval performance and effects of source population, as well as some of the underlying kind of genetic and transcriptional mechanisms that might be underlying any shifts, and integrating those with stochastic models of ocean circulation and connectivity that can be fed into process-based models to test hypotheses, to see the degree to which we can recreate some of those patterns with under different hypotheses. So this is collaboration with Laura at Bodega Bay, Rachel Simons at UCSB, and now we're going to be doing some of these experiments at the Hackeye Institute as well. So we can try to think about all this orders of magnitude variation larval supply that is that's potentially impactful. But you know, there's arguments about the degree to which any of that settlement actually matters in the first place, right? So does variation in reproduction and settlement even matter for the year class strength of these animals? And we do see some correlation between the number of settlers and per brush per day when you take an average across the whole Santa Barbara Channel and an average of the number of juveniles basically the juvenile year class strength that you might infer just from the size distribution and those number of animals, right? So you can squint and see some correlations that are significant. But you know, the question really is what happens on benthos? And if we look up in Northern California, so that was for the Santa Barbara Channel, there is obviously these large scale regional events that are happening up in Northern California, leading to the demise of the iconic kelp forests in that region. And what we had seen was, at least where we have monitoring of juveniles in Northern California, we had a period that was really a period of fairly low larval settlement from the early 2000s leading into that marine heat wave. But once 2013, 2014, 2015, 2016 came around, we saw an increase in the larval supply at Fort Bragg. Quite of a large increase, in fact. And that tended to coincide, we saw that settlement increase 2013 through 2016 plus, but we also saw this extirpation of the sunflower star, or inferred extirpation, I suppose, of that sunflower star in 2014 plus minus, right? And the increase in the number of urchins in that other habitat. And what we end up seeing, we just run some simple correlations between the juvenile density. So in this case, this is the juveniles that we would observe in Laura's arm data. And we tend to see an increase in the number of animals associated with that larval impulse that tends to translate to higher juvenile densities associated with that. And so, you know, what we have is basically a before after where there's more larval supply and where there's less larval supply. And we also see an increase in the juveniles. So it becomes a little bit of a statistical problem to try to disentangle because you have basically an N of two. But what there is a hypothesis about this kind of perfect storm, that there's this increase in larval supply, this decline in pycnopodia that can feed on juvenile urchins, and an increase in juvenile urchins and a decrease in kelp. Because of course you have to have some input into the system to create new individuals. But you also have to potentially have the predatory release to allow those individuals to mature. And so in order to try to address what the degree to which this is actually what's going on in the benthos, we're going to try to use some size structured models to evaluate whether or not this is really a recruitment effect or some other hypothesis like behavioral shifts that lead to the appearance of many more large individuals right away. And so one of the challenges when thinking about these is that these settler recruitment correlations, of course, are really regional. We see these on the large scale, but things that are happening on different reefs, like I've said in Southern California, we see these mosaics of reefs that are doing very different things. And one of the things we want to be able to know is what are the relative roles of recruitment and mortality in driving the dynamics on local scales. And so what we have is we've built some novel tools for estimating trends in recruitment and mortality, fluctuations in recruitment and mortality from size structure data and abundance data that we can integrate when it has high resolution and high quality. So there are kind of four test sites that we've used in Southern California to try to test models that can disentangle these different processes by using some Bayesian tools. And just briefly, what we use is what's called an integrated integral projection state space model. So Will White has talked about some versions of models like this. This is actually an integrated analysis. It takes different kinds of data sets and puts them together. And also we can estimate these in your kind of classically available Bayesian numerical integration frameworks like STAN or JAGS or, you know, kind of pick your own, choose your own adventure. But the key feature here is that we can integrate these with a spatially correlated, what we call Gaussian process models. And those allow us to integrate and try to estimate time varying trends in mortality and recruitment at the same time, which is actually quite a difficult thing to do. And all we're doing is basically taking a forward projection, integral projection model, forecasting that forward, adjusting for some observation error and some process error, and trying to match that with the data sets that we observe, and integrating in these time varying trends in mortality and recruitment. I won't go too much more into the models, but what we end up getting is estimated trends in density. So these are kind of our reconstructions of what we think the densities are based upon the observations that we have and the model assumptions about growth and various other assumptions that go into the model to be able to tease out these patterns. And so Carpentry and Mohawk, I've talked about those reefs and some of those trends in the past, earlier in the talk. But just to remind you guys, so Carpentry was an urchin baron, and Mohawk in the blue and the open circles was a pretty healthy kelp forest. And we also have Naples Reef, which was basically a demise of a pretty strong urchin baron, and Arroyo Camaro, which was that urchin baron that I showed you from the air. That was formed a very strong urchin baron from a healthy kelp forest. And one of the things you'll notice is that around this marine heat wave, there's a pretty strong decline at all of these different sites, even though there's some recovery in Carpinteria and not so much recovery until later for some of the other sites. But we have four sites that are all kind of doing different things with some synchronous events. And we can parse out the stochastic mortality particularly with these kind of synchronous trends, although partially synchronous, I suppose, around that marine heat wave, where we see actually a pretty strong decline in the abundance of individuals that we can infer is at least a partial mortality event associated with that marine heat wave, in contrast to just kind of asynchronous patterns of trends in mortality. And this is these kind of average mortalities, and this is, we're actually showing survival probability on the y-axis. But these trends tend to be consistent with what we think about with the life history of purple urchins, with having, you know, punctuated periods of high survival and punctuated periods of high mortality associated with those dynamics. But the recruitment dynamics is where we see some interesting trends. So Arroyo Camaro and Mohawk, we see these kind of modest recruitment, and that just kind of falls away after the marine heat wave, and who knows why. But Carpinteria and Naples, we see very different trends. In Carpinteria in particular, we see high recruitment throughout that period that tends to persist. And we think a lot of that is due to the fact that there may be just higher recruitment in urchin barrens because of the lack of predators and some sheltering and other characteristics that make those areas actually quite good for juveniles. But what we end up seeing is both mortality and recruitment tend to vary dramatically and are contributing to the dynamics and the volatility in these purple urchin populations, but in very different ways in the different habitats, which makes trying to understand what's going on with larger scale regional settlement patterns and how that influences the benthos quite a challenge until you can start to bring in what's going on the local scale to try to characterize that. And that's what we're doing now. So what we do is see a spatial variation, recruitment and mortality trends to explain these dynamics, some higher mortality during the marine heat wave of 2013 to 2015. And that's backed up by observations and lots of tests kind of laying around in those reefs, which now we wish we would have collected. And then the next steps is basically taking some of these models into broader data sets in California and British Columbia to assess the roles of settlement and integration with multi-species models especially up in British Columbia for some model errors we have going on. So I'm gonna move now up from California up into Haida Gwaii to talk about red urchin barrens and some of the physiological feedbacks and restoration efforts we have going on there. So Haida Gwaii is this archipelago up here under the cloud, and it's actually quite appropriate. It's actually, that's kind of what it feels like most of the time when you're up there. is gray, rainy, and a little gloomy sometimes. But these habitats are really characterized by shallow nereocystis beds, bull kelp beds that are just intensely productive with a lot of healthy understory. But most of that habitat is really relegated to these shallow water hummocks in the shallow zones. So these are just little zones that, and beneath that is a lot of urchins that basically we think are relegated to the deeper zones because of surf surge and potentially some salinity effects. But if you're an urchin that has happened to find your way into those shallow zones, you're gonna really enjoy yourself. There's a lot of food there. And it's just kind of this conveyor belt of a smorgasbord. And you have all these little critters that really feast on probably the feces and the other stuff that's being captured. So you can see a northern abalone and some snails and other things enjoying this little get together. But the animals that are left in the deep that have seemed to have lost their way, they are relegated to these habitats that are suboptimal, not a lot of intrinsic production outside of encrusting coral and algae. Maybe you get some protein from these dodecaseria, and lots of other animals seem to be able to persist by scratching off a living, but it's certainly devoid of the massive kelp primer production that we're used to characterizing these nearshore reefs. And there is, of course, lots of epilithic production. So this is an abalone that's cruising away from this little grazing scar on these encrusting algae. But these barrens have been here for decades. And in some cases, centuries. So this is George Dawson in Haida Gwaii, and this is some work. Lynn Lee had done a bunch of ethnographic work trying to understand the history of barrens in these habitats. And this is a quote from George Dawson, basically indicating these urchin barrens were persisting in these habitats. And really, we think this has been going on since the local extirpation of sea otters almost 200 years ago. So these urchin barrens, we believe, have been there for decades or even centuries. And so from the central coast of British Columbia all the way up through the north coast, there are these kind of depth gradients where you have small amounts of shallow water production, lots of urchins hanging out down deep. And on the inside waters, most of these are big red urchins. And so our questions are, why are red urchin and barrens able to persist for so long? And given the kind of life history, can harvesters and the fact that they're commercially viable, can harvesters reduce densities over large scale to actually allow for kelp forest reforestation? And so to address that first question, there are a few hypotheses that have been posed. One is some work we did in the San Juan Islands, where we were looking at shallow water production and how that gets down into deep water. And even animals at 100 feet can be super fat and happy because they're just getting all this conveyor belt of drift algae that's coming down from the shallows. And there's also the potential for movement of just animals coming up and having a meal and then going back down to maintain that shallow water kelp production where they can't quite get to, but then denuding the deep water zones where they spend most of their time. But the other hypothesis that's certainly interesting that are not mutually exclusive is energetic plasticity, right? So we know that animals can change their growth patterns and their energy allocation by utilizing their energy reserves. But we also believe that there's really strong capacity for metabolic plasticity in response to food availability. And we can measure that using respirometry. And then we can also look at dietary shifts to alternative resources using things like fatty acid analysis. So when we've been generating time series of gonad indices associated with these urchin barren habitats and the associated kelp forest, we find is about a 75% reduction in the gonad size of the animals for a given animal of a given size. Now, of course, that goes away once you get to an animal that's small enough. We think these small animals are able to just scratch a living by on not very much at all. But for the larger animals, the ones that are commercially viable, they are no longer commercially viable in the barrens in these habitats. And this is what urchin fishermen are looking for. So look at growth. We basically take these bandoliers of tetracycline down underwater and we just tag thousands of animals. This is my PhD student, Nate Spindle, up with me in Haida Gwaii. And we're, this was two years ago. We didn't actually get to collect these animals because we didn't get to go diving, but we collected the animals a couple years prior. And we tag thousands of animals and then come back in a year, collect them and measure their jaws and try to look at growth patterns. And what we see is a pretty strong size-specific cross in the growth rates of these animals that are inferred from those tags. And so we estimate these growth models. And what we can look at is two different sites where we tagged lots of animals and looked for differences in growth rates in the barrens versus the kelp and the red versus the blue. We tend to see about a 30% reduction in size-specific growth rate. And that does tend to go away as animals get smaller. And it tends to be harder to detect once animals get bigger. But in this zone where animals are really growing and where they're fairly large, we do see a pretty strong reduction in the growth rate. So this is the size of the animal and the annual growth increment, a pretty strong reduction in annual growth rates of those animals. So we can see that they've resorbed their gonads and they're reducing their growth rates in response to that lack of food availability in those habitats. And one of the things we were interested in is also looking at, well, what other kind of physiological responses might we be able to observe? And how can we, and especially ones that we can use in trying to think about physiologically structured models. So we went up to the Hack Eye Institute. This is just it was one of those few beautiful bluebird days in the British Columbia that I think people in California take advantage of, take for granted, maybe not where you guys live. But we went up to the Hack Eye Institute and Haida Gwaii to look at metabolic rates of a bunch of these animals in different kinds of habitats. So this is on Quadra Island near the Hack Eye Institute. And so Nate and I went up knowing that this was something we wanted to measure. And because urchins have fairly low metabolic rates, we also had to construct our own custom urchin respirometry systems using flow-through respirometry with kind of precise flow-through cells. We can get really good metrics of oxygen drawdown in these animals in comparison to the controls. And what we end up seeing is size-specific metabolic rates that decline dramatically in the barrens. So this is just wet mass on the x-axis and oxygen consumption on the y-axis. And this is two sites in Haida Gwaii and one site around the Hack Eye Institute off the east side of Vancouver Island. And for all the different sites, we see a strong reduction in metabolic rate, about a 50% reduction in the metabolic rate standardized by the wet mass. Now, of course, the wet mass includes the test diameter, the test, which is metabolically inert. And so to look at the comparison of the tissues that would actually be consuming oxygen, we had to look at ash free dry mass, and we see that same trend persist when we're just standardizing by the soft tissue biomass that we would observe. And we see this about somewhere between 40 and 50% reduction in oxygen drawdown associated with these animals per unit size of the soft tissue mass that is metabolically demanding. And so we have a few hypotheses for why we think this happens. One is that the resorption of the gonads leads to a different combination of tissue proportional representation in those animals, meaning that there is a strong change in that composition, meaning different cell types potentially have different metabolic demands. The other is that there's a potentially just cellular shift in metabolic demands in response to energetic availability. And that's something that we'd like to be able to disentangle next. And the cool thing about this is, the animals are depressing their metabolic rate one way or the other. But if you feed those animals, they just chow down. There is no difference between the consumption rates of those animals, their appetite, even comparing the barrens and the kelp. In fact, it might be slightly more. This is an experiment that Nate did where he was feeding those animals and looking at the response. And we also have bacterial-derived fatty acids to look at differences in dietary composition. And what we see in the barrens is an increase in the fatty acid that would be associated with bacterial synthesis. And this potentially indicates some other dietary inputs, although we're doing a lot of work in these are kind of new data. We're trying to understand what's going on in this system. So stay tuned for more results on that. Now, the question then is, there's the issue of how does all this matter? And so what we did was we were trying to look at, well, can we actually do some restoration given that we know these animals can persist for super long periods of time in these habitats? And so in Haida Gwaii, we partnered with Haida, DFO, and various other groups, and Parks Canada was leading this effort to do a restoration of about 3 kilometers in comparison to a control. And so what we have is a strong agency, community, NGO, academic partnership that's led by a bunch of Haida fisheries divers, our team, as well as Parks Canada's team as well. And what we did was basically set up a Bakke design. And partway through that Bakke time series, we had the harvesters go through and just lay waste to the urchins, either by harvesting or smashing lots of those urchins and just doing a cull. And some of those urchins were brought back to the community, and some of them were sold to the animals that are in the shallows that are fat and healthy. And the remainder were just smashed. So this is, you know, hundreds of thousands of urchins that are culled. We haven't done a final estimate. That's kind of next on my to-do list of, you know, are we in the millions of urchins that are culled? But you do see, in comparison to the control, a dramatic reduction in the number of urchins and the urchin density at all different depths associated with this that was able to persist at least until 2019, which was my last field campaign up there because of the pandemic. And we see massive responses of kelp. So this is before. These are some drone imagery from Hackeye, and after in that restoration and versus post-restoration. And we see a strong response of Nereocystis only. So we actually saw very few other kelps come into the system. But in the restoration, we saw a big bump in Nereocystis, lots of recruitment. We did see some Macrocystis as well. But in the shallow zone, in the control, we also saw an increase. So we think this was just a good year for Nereocystis. But in the depths in the control, we didn't see any recruitment of Nereocystis. And that's where all the urchins are. And what we saw was at the shallow zones, we saw an increase in gonads, which was interesting in the control. This is actually the shallow zone where there's not a lot of urchins, but the urchins can access some of that nearshore production. And in the barrens, we saw no response in the control, but a strong increase in the restoration site. So that means the gonad production, the animals that were in the restoration site after the restoration responded right away in terms of their gonad yield, meaning these animals that are left in the restoration site are now commercially viable. And so we see is that red urchins exhibit these really strong physiological plasticity in barrens, decreases in value associated with gonad production, growth, changes in mass-specific metabolic rate, and potential alternative dietary sources for munching on endogenous production. But we also see this capacity for rapid restoration and increases in Nereocystis and urchin condition. And what we're trying to understand is this something that can, because of the initial activation energy, the very low recruitment of urchins in these systems compared to purple urchins, we get about a tenth of the amount of recruitment and the longevity of these animals. Can this initial activation energy lead to a small scale self-sustainable restoration effort in partnership with industry? Now, we don't expect this to be a large-scale thing, but can you have local efforts at restoration with red urchins that can be sustainable? And so just briefly, in a couple of minutes, I want to talk a little bit about how some of this work leads into thinking about equity and science for conservation and management. So every one of these areas that I've talked about, every one of these urchin barrens, every one of these kelp forests is on some indigenous groups' traditional and ancestral territories, or within the territories that are within the waters that are adjacent to their territories. And when we're thinking about that, you know, we have a huge colonial history of resource management, right? And so all these barrens, in many ways, are persisting for long periods in the way they are, in part because of the local extirpation of these critters. And we also have a huge colonial history of resource management and lots of other things, right? Like the harvesting of abalone with impunity to the point of the demise of many of those species, and some of which are recovering and some of which are in a tough go. But we like to think about this as being something that's in our past. But much of this is there is an institutionalized legacy of these kind of colonial impacts of the ways in which people have used fisheries as a weapon to marginalize indigenous people. And we've moved beyond a lot of that weaponization, but many of those institutions that were formed for management and conservation were formed during an era of intense colonialism. And here's a couple examples of the way in which those legacies can persist, right? So herring fisheries in 2015 and 2014 up in the Central Coast. So in 2014, the fisheries minister in Canada opened the herring fishery against management advice. And in 2015, there was kind of some questions about whether or not it should be opened. And the Heltsik put out a notice saying their territory was closed to fisheries. And yet the fishery was opened despite that notice and leading to lots of conflict, occupation of government buildings and protests. And much of this comes from the dissonance associated with the ways in which populations and stocks are defined and the scales at which people operate. So you know, when looking at the population as a whole, if you draw a line, a giant box around multiple First Nations traditional territories and call that a stock, and things might look just fine and you can prosecute a harvest. But when you zoom in on individual spawning areas and traditional fishing grounds is where you start to see this real change in how you perceive what the stock is doing and where you think you might want to harvest and how you might go about managing and prosecuting a fishery. And this brings about kind of this cognitive dissonance between, on the one hand, trying to understand local scale conservation, and on the other hand, trying to maintain sustainable fisheries at a large scale. And so these seemingly sustainable strategies, when we're looked at from a particular science lens, can often either fail with poor governance or the wrong objectives, or science that's informed from a particular viewpoint. And we have this kind of mode of thinking about the nation state as being the ideal entity for thinking about what the objectives are. But in many ways, there's a value in decentralizing the perspectives and the views of who gets to decide what the objectives are, what the right scientific questions are, and what the right way to think about an ecosystem is in a model or in some other framework. And so there's a need for thinking about this kind of cycle between historical colonialism and the ways in which it has generated the institutions that we have, and how it influences the objectives and the way in which we think about fishery science, and trying to break out of that system by thinking about the equity in who science is for and who participates in science, and the ideas that are pervasive in science in each of our individual and respective disciplines. And that's something that is quite difficult to do, because it requires a lot more introspection than it does just at each one of these individual points than it does kind of large scale, individual, small scale, individual, large scale or small scale policy changes. So I'll end my rant, but I want to thank everybody for listening. And I'm hoping that at least, kind of this glide through a bunch of empirical data and analysis that we have on some of these really fascinating systems that are really important for a lot of people has been something that at least hopefully you learned something. And for me, it's been valuable to talk to you all so I can get at least an introduction to who I am before you see my face in the near future. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dan. And we'd be happy to have folks post their questions in the Q&A. And I also want to remind people at BML that Dan is also available for a few more of the one-on-one Zoom meetings, both Thursday morning and Thursday afternoon, as well as Friday morning or Friday afternoon. Both of the middle of those days are busy, but we entertain folks emailing me and we can set up Zoom meetings with Dan. Before we do that, I'd like to thank Dan very much for a fascinating talk. Obviously, this is an issue that's of prime importance for us in Sonoma and Mendocino counties, where we host about 90% of the bull kelp forests in Northern California. So this is right in our backyard. And I'd just like to start us off with a question. Thinking back to some of the mortality events of the adults during the heat wave that you quantified down in Northern California, do you have any sense of whether those were direct heat wave impacts in terms of lethal temperatures or disease or a combination? What's the thinking for some of those mortalities?
Yeah, so that's a good question. It's something to dig into. I mean, the challenge is that trying to estimate upper thermal limits for a lot of animals in a lab versus in the field under different conditions is difficult. And so what you might observe is those might not have been what you expect to be like, fully lethal temperatures over short term, but when they're exposed over long periods, you might expect kind of different responses, potentially to, susceptibility to disease or, kind of giving into starvation. So it's really hard to say because of the kind of prolonged nature of those events, really, you know, throughout multiple seasons and years. So we were not expecting those kinds of changes with a heat wave like that. So it was surprising, but it's kind of mind-boggling at the same time. Yeah. So yeah, that's probably not a satisfying answer, but I'm sure there's lots of ways to look into that. Yeah.
That combination of heat stress and starvation stress may be playing a role there too, multiple factors. We have a question in the Q&A from Eric Sanford. Thanks for a great talk. And thinking about the urchin settlement data in slide 42, it looked like settlement in Fort Bragg was bimodal with peaks around March and August. What is known about the drivers of this bimodal pattern in the north? And do you have thoughts on why it appears that there is only a single annual recruitment peak in sites in Southern California?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And it's something we've kind of been puzzling over. You know, one of the challenges is thinking about the reproductive cycles. That, to me, that is not necessarily something that is, you know, in certain seasons, you have a lot better survival. It's very likely due to kind of spawning phenology. And why you might have those in those geographic, why those might vary geographically is kind of a really interesting question, and probably, you know, requires its own kind of intensive line of inquiry. So at Friday Harbor, when I was working up there, we were doing seasonal metrics of reproduction, and we would get kind of bimodal scenario for red urchins in this kind of doing timing for a spring bloom and then a fall bloom. And we tend to see that fall bloom up there because in the summer you get a decline in production because I think it's because of nutrient declines, but it's been a long time since I've worked in the Salish Sea. But then you have a return in the fall. So there's a kind of a bimodal peak of productivity that animals would want to time reproduction for. My guess is there may be a kind of an ancestral and historical reason for that timing, or there's something associated with spawning cues in response to chlorophyll. So there are some other systems where animals will respond to chlorophyll abundance for spawning time. I think that's something that would be requires, I mean, raises interesting questions that are things that certainly can be evaluated in interesting ways. So not another kind of non-satisfying answer, but it is puzzling and interesting. But what's interesting about that is those seasonal trends are really clear and consistent. So even in a poor year, you still, those seasonal trends tend to maintain. It's just a matter of magnitude.
Okay, that's great. So we have promised to end on time here at 2:00. And I'm sure that if there are any other questions that I didn't get to in the Q&A, you can give those questions to Dan in an email, or again, we can set up a one-on-one meeting over Zoom. And I just wanna thank Dan one last time for coming to Zooming over to BML to talk with us here at CMSI. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everybody.